We begin the event with the university song. I request everyone to rise for the university song. Vatsala, we begin with the university song?
Yes, yes, yes. Just give me a second. Just yes. Give me a
विश्व है परिवार भारत घर हमारा है
सहता कौन हम अबला
नहीं
है दीन कहता कौन है
ज्योति से जगमग हुआ
अरे
for the poor audio quality. A warm welcome to Honorable Madam Vice Chancellor, our esteemed guest Devaki Jain, our guest of honor Professor Veena Punacha, then Professor Abhibhuti Patel, senior scholars, and my dear participants. I once again welcome everyone to the 11th Meera Desai Memorial Lecture. I now request Professor Vibhuti Patel, a close associate of Dr. Neera Desai and the former head of the Economics Department, SNDT Women's University, to speak about the contribution of Dr. Neera Desai to women's studies. Professor Vibhuti Patel.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Putul Sathe. First of all, I would like to greet Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Sashikala Vanjari, today's chief keynote speaker, Devaki ji, whom I respect a great deal. She has been active in the women's movement and women's studies for past 50 years. Dr. Professor Veena Punacha, Professor, and all the esteemed participants. I see so many known faces, friends, and relatives of Neeraben who are here, and for past 11 years, all of them have been coming in a great number. On this occasion of 11th Dr. Neera Desai Memorial Lecture, I would like to first of all like to profile her intellectual contribution to the discipline of women's studies. Neeraben was a heterodox women's studies scholar and doyen, leading light of women's studies movement. In her younger days, she was ideologically influenced by socialist thinkers. During the 70s, she found Latin American thinkers like Paulo Freire and Ivan Illich very impressive, and their methods of reaching out to the marginalized groups through non-formal methods of education. She tried to apply methodology of conscientization as an educationist. During early 70s, she leaned towards thinkers of the social movements where she highlighted women's rights as human rights. She had friends in all schools of thought. The three cardinal principles that governed Mirabai's intellectual engagements were liberal humanism, Gandhism in praxis, and Marxism in social justice concerns, and feminism as a prime motive force. Mirabai's persona, when we talk about that, we all, many those who have worked with her, they know that she was a gentle, kind, critical but not combative, soft-spoken but firm. Mirabai had a wonderful sense of self-deprecating humor. She was passionate about ideas, but not herself. She was warm, generous at heart, humane with her colleagues and juniors, courteous with authorities. She was a networker who built the bridges between scholars and experts, activists and academicians, policymakers and political activists from different ideological moorings. And that was the secret of the success of the first Indian Association, founding conference of Indian Association of Women's Studies way back in 1981, where I was one of the core committee members. She was child friendly. Sons and daughters of Research Center for Women's Studies eagerly awaited her arrival so that she could share toffees that she always kept in her purse. Veena would bear with me. Veena Punacha, she can vouch for it. On a personal note, I would like to share a story. During 90s, we worked closely to bring out Gujarati quarterly called Nari Mukti in Gujarati. We also co-authored country reports for United Nations End of the Decade Conference in Nairobi in 1985. And we worked for a mammoth assignment from ICSSR to prepare status report on critical evaluation of women's studies researches in India from 1947 to 1988. And had to go through 3 bags full of research cards and abstract, people used to call it dowry. We had 50-50, anytime I collaborated with Mirabai, we had always 50-50 responsibility, 50% work she did, 50% work I did, though I was 30 years younger than her. There was always an equality in our relationship. While preparing the final draft, we stayed at the same place. Either she would come and stay with me or I would go to her house and stay with her. I had to take my little daughter. She was in those 3 years, she was from 1 year to 3 years. Wherever we stayed at her residence, she would bring me up enthusiastically and tell, Vibhuti, I have procured VHS of Mr. India for Lara to see her favorite movie. While we were working, anytime Lara would come, she would barge into our room abruptly and start conversation, and I would get upset. The room would be, because our room would be full of research references. You know, those days we used to spread our cards according to thematic areas and books and documents. Sometimes even the books, the pile of books were so high, we were not even visible. So Mirabai would pacify me and say, see, this is the first child I have ever seen who doesn't damage any papers. She is so respectful of our papers, of our work, no? She made a stupendous contribution in terms of like in her academic stars were in ascendance in the 70s, during the 70s and 70s onwards, I would say. Though her first book, Women in Modern India, had come out in 1955, the year I was born. Her research on Bhakti movement from 12th century to 16th century and the social reform movement of 19th century inspired young scholars to examine liberating aspects of their writings, debates, poetry, symbolism, and varied art forms. She played crucial role in the Towards Equality Report 1974, Shramashakti Report of Government of India in 1988, and National Perspective Plan for Women from 1988 to 2000 AD. During the 90s, she took up major challenge of profiling lives and contributions of 100 feminists from Western India by using qualitative research method. This mammoth task took 17 years to complete. So many of the young people, we were also assisting her in collecting all those, because Mirabai always worked on a shoestring budget. So a lot of volunteerism was required. As a result, a solid volume emerged in the form of Feminism as Experience, Thoughts and Narratives, published by Sparrow in 2007. Her research and writings in English and Gujarati reflect a deep concern for issues of gender and power and relentless effort to understand social construction of feminist ideology. She collaborated with young scholars like me to produce training manuals for rural women in Gujarati or women's studies series she produced with Dr. Usha Thakkar. And she was not only just a friend, a philosopher and guide, but also she built 2 generations of women's studies scholars. her hallmark achievements were like in leaving her legacy of dedication to women's studies among next generation of teachers and researchers. This is the most important accomplishment of any women's studies foremother who worked with a great sense of commitment and honesty of purpose. Her companionship with Dr. A.R. Desai, both of them, they were true sense of the term companion. They collaborated on several missions. They brought out a Samajik Vignan Mala, Samaj Vignan Mala, a social science series. Now also, Chandrika Ben will bear with me that yes, it is being used as a textbook in so many departments, in so many sociology departments in Gujarat. As both had a both of them had a generous temperament. Their relationship facilitated synergy in their work and that made them as a couple stronger and better in their personal and academic endeavor. They kept their home throbbing with animated discussions and debates. They organized study circles on contemporary issues. And I think so many times Mihir also must have felt uncomfortable with all the youngsters like us barging in their house and just engaging them in the discussion for hours together. Six broad areas of Neera Ben's contribution can be elicited as demystifying structures of patriarchy as a sociologist, bringing out nuances of household strategies of women from the marginalized sections and women's contribution in the subsistence economy, importance of oral history and significance of qualitative research. Fourth is a symbolic relation of the symbiotic relationship between theory and practice, and hence the relationship between women studies and women's movement, transformative education, and also legitimization of women's studies as an academic discipline, which was such a Herculean task. Nearly for 30 years of her life, Neera Ben was always targeted in the Indian Sociological Associations as a person. People would just humorously just say that, oh, she's only women focused. And she had to hammer the women's concerns in the sociological discourses. After her retirement from SNDT Women's University, for her research work, she collaborated with Professor Veena Majumdar from CWDS in Delhi, ICSSR sponsored first Women's Studies Center, Dr. Trupti Shah and Ms. Siraj Balsara on qualitative study of household strategies. Professor Veena Punacha, she played a very important role in that qualitative study of 100 feminists. Professor Usha Thakkar, with whom she also brought out a book published by National Book Center, which is highly popular, the cheapest women's studies, most affordable women's studies book we have in India, published by National Book Trust, and it is also translated in several Indian languages. With her colleague, Shrimati Kumud Shanbagh, she continued her engagement with a PET project, research action research project in Udwada. What we miss in the absence of Neera Desai is a mother figure who personified solidarity. She built institutions. She built younger generation of feminists through her writings. One-to-one communication she had, knowledge construction in a participatory manner with humility to respect collective wisdom of the women's rights movement. She truly practiced mantra of think and act both locally and globally. Her doors were always open for new ideas, for her peers, for her students, and for practitioners. Let us cheer this fantastic personality who opened our lives to women's studies as an academic discipline and motivated us to have a lifelong commitment to women's studies movement from whichever location we were, whether we were in Women's Studies Center or any other academic discipline or in the women's movement or as activists and practitioner. I congratulate Research Center for Women's Studies for organizing annual memorial lecture in honor of Neera Ben to celebrate her most inspiring life, unusual personality, who was one of the limited edition women, as I think we can say that she had very, very, such women you rarely find in today's era. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you, Professor Patel. And now I will request Vatsala Shukla to introduce Honorable Vice Chancellor Madam. Hello.
Yeah.
Yes.
Hello. Yes. Yeah. So over to Vatsala Shukla.
Thank you.
Vatsala, be brief.
Yes, madam. Thank you, Dr. Kukul Patel, Professor Vibhuti Patel. As we commemorate 95th birth anniversary of Neera Ben, and before I proceed with the program, it's indeed a proud privilege for me to take the opportunity to introduce Honorable Madam Vice Chancellor, Professor Shashikala Banjari. She has served in different academic and administrative capacities. Her academic approach is an amalgamation of scientific, social, literary, and educational perspectives and insights. She is a member of various professional bodies at national and international level. Under her versatile leadership, the university has signed several MOUs and established relations with many institutions of repute at national and international level. She has visited many countries for educational purposes. Her dynamic leadership and vision since she took over the leadership of the SNDT Women's University in 2016 has created an environment of academic growth and excellence in the university. She's been conferred the rank of honorary colonel in 2018 for promoting NCC activities in the university. Rooted in the legacy and footprints of our founder, Bharat Ratna Maharshi Karve, her vision and mission for the university is to encourage, emancipate, and empower each and every woman with the tool of education, skill development, and economic empowerment. May I request Madam to come over and deliver her introductory address. Welcome.
Thank you, Vatsala. Very good afternoon to one and all. Honorable Padma Bhushan, Dr. Devki Jain, eminent development economist and writer. My head of the department, Dr. Putul Sate of Department of Research Center for Women's Studies, our senior professor, Meena Punacha Madam, Dr. Vibhuti Patel, and all SNDT fraternity, all well-wishers of the university. On the occasion of this 11th Dr. Neera Desai Memorial Lecture, I would welcome you all. I extend warm greetings to one and all on behalf of the university. After going through the brief introduction which was given by our senior most professor, Dr. Vibhuti Patel, what I have drawn from it, Dr. Neera Desai was an instrumental in nurturing the symbiotic relationship between theory and practice. It's a very difficult task to understand the relationship between theory and practice. And I got to know that Dr. Neera Desai was such a lady who inspired not only the staff of SNDT, but in the entire academia. So definitely to commemorate this day by having this 11th memorial lecture, and for that lecture, Dr. Devki Jain is here. Madam, I am highly delighted to know about you also, Dr. Devki Jain, because whatever our senior professor, she read out about the Dr. Neera Desai, and I know that, I got to know that, the what aim, what focus she made throughout this department, Research Center for Women's Studies. Definitely through your lecture, Devki Madam, we will get the spirit to work for the women. And through your thoughts, definitely my SNDT women will be encouraged to do something for the women. And that would be the tribute to Dr. Neera Desai. I hope through your lecture and through your deliberation, we will understand what exactly this feminist leadership, which was emerges from the continent of Africa. It's not my subject, feminism. I do not have much interest in feminism, but being a vice chancellor of this university, I understood little bit things from you people. So definitely working with the women university, I wish to remind myself, yes, there are such ladies like Dr. Neera Desai, who had worked for the Society of Women, and they brought so many things to the light. Already Patel madam has spoke about the her contribution in qualitative research. It is very difficult to work in that area. And Dr. Neera Desai was an expert to throw light on qualitative research. Definitely, I would be highly delighted to have your speech in my university. And in the last part of my address, I would compliment Dr. Putul Sathe and Dr. Vatsala and other members who belongs to RCWS. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for those kind words. And now I have the daunting task of introducing Devki Jain. Devki Jain is a development feminist and writer. She was the honorary fellow at St. Anne's College, Oxford University in December 2016. She was the recipient of a Padma Vibhushan in 2006. She was one of the three members in the South Commission. She was also one of the two women who received the Bradford Morse Memorial Award, which was instituted by the United Nations Development Fund at the World Conference at Beijing in 1995 for her contribution in advancing the cause of women and gender equality for 20 years. She was also awarded the honorary doctorate from the University of Westvilla, Durban, for her contribution to international development in 1983. She has also been the recipient of various fellowships. In fact, I would like to make a I would like to mention some of these. She was the UGC. She was recipient of the UGC Senior Fellowship at the Center for Advanced Studies, Delhi School of Economics. She was the visiting fellow at the Scandinavian Institute for Asian Studies, Copenhagen. She was awarded Fulbright Fellowship in 1984, and she was also incorporated as honorary fellow at Harvard University, where she conducted a course on the life and thought of Mahatma Gandhi. And this course has now become a part of the core curriculum at Harvard. She was the honorary fellow at World Development Institute, Boston University. She was an honorary fellow at IDS, Sussex University, where she closely worked with Professor Hans Singer to develop a framework for development policy. She has been a member of various policy framing bodies. And here, in fact, I would like to mention some of these. She was a member of the steering committee set up by Government of India for preparing reports for the United Nations World Conference on Women in 1975, 1980, 1985, and 1995. She was a member of the Karnataka State Planning Board. She was a member of various expert groups set up by Government of India and United Nations. She is also the founding member of several important, we can say, associations, and also this institution. She has been one of the founding members of Indian Association for Women's Studies, one of the founding members of the publishing house Akali for Women, one of the founder members of Dawn, which is a South-South network of women scholars. She's also the founder member of Third World Organization of Women in Science. She's the founder member of International Network for Engineers and Scientists. She has also been a member of the expert groups of set up by United Nations to study the impact on children of armed conflict. She was also a member of the three-member Eminent Economist Committee set up to evaluate various UN development programs. She has also been affiliated to various organizations at the national and international level. And in fact, I would like to mention a few. A member of the editorial board of World Development from USA. She was a member of the Council of Management of National Institute of Advanced Study, Bangalore. member of the governing council of the Indian Council for Cultural Relations, Government of India, adjunct senior fellow at the Delhi Policy Group, member of the advisory council of the India International Center, New Delhi, a member of the task force on NREGA, which comes under Ministry of Rural Development. And finally, she has authored many books. She has also edited many books. And I should add here, I would like to mention her latest books, which is Close Encounters of Another Kind, which has been published by Sage, and also Journeys of a Southern Feminist. I would now invite Devki Jain to deliver the 11th Dr. Neera Desai lecture. Yes, madam, please. Vatsala, ma'am.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, yes, ma'am, we can hear you. Yes, we can hear.
So I must first say I'm so grateful to all of you, particularly Dr. Putul Sarthaya, who wish I could meet her, for inviting me to deliver the 11th Dr. Neera Desai Memorial Lecture. If I may be frank, and even perhaps a little naughty, I will say that I've been hoping for this invite for a very long time. Jaw-dropping when I saw so many other names. Being now of the ripe old age of 87, it looks as if I can just squeeze myself in into the door for the last of the lectures. And you're truly honored. I cannot help wishing, though, that it could have been at a time when we could actually physically be at SNDT with the audience, not this awful thing called webinar, Zoom, etc., where you don't feel the human touch. But the joy of giving lectures in the name of dear friends is to see them and see them in the audience. I feel, alas, that that was not possible for me. Neera Ben and I were very good friends. A lot has been said about her, which is worthy. We had a lot to do with each other. We were founding members of the IAWS. Its registration took place in New Delhi in my office under the guidance of the wonderful Madhuri Ben Shah. Much has been said about Neera Ben, how hardworking she was, how warm-hearted, brilliant, and an outstanding leader. Today, I want to take you to Africa, to what used to be called the dark continent, and now, in my view, is the continent of hope. My purpose in doing this is because I believe Africa is leading the world in refreshing and adapting feminism to its own continental features, something that we, I think, need to do. Please indulge me as I share a personal story on the naming of this lecture. My husband, the late S.D. Jain, was appointed as the Indian High Commissioner to South Africa in 1998, the last year of Nelson Mandela's leadership and presidentship. It was the most thrilling, unexpected gift for us to be in South Africa. Their oppression and their courage was part of everybody's lives in India. Someday I would like to tell you the story about South Africa and what we did. But in a small ceremony called Receiving Credentials, a short speech had to be made in front of Nelson Mandela. My husband called his little speech Africa, the Continent of Hope, as he really believed that while other continents were getting tired and in some ways scarred, Africa and its leaders were being more affirmative, and as former colonies would probably lead the South. Many of you may know that most of the countries colonized by the white people were in the continents of the South. And indeed, the South Commission, of which Nyerere was the chairperson and I was a member, was again an African initiative. Mandela was thrilled and excited at the idea contained in my husband's speech, saying, We will make this happen, when my husband said, Africa is the continent of hope. And indeed, as I continue with my story on feminism and feminist ideas in the continent of Africa, you will see the truth in that hope. So in this lecture, I suggest that the African continent has become the lead continent for feminist thought and action, overtaken all other continents, including South Asia, which was once the darling of women's studies and feminist organizing. Africa is the world's second largest and second most populous continent after Asia in both cases. It is composed of 54 member countries. I would like to start by sharing two exposures I had to the amazing patakas, as I call it, crackers or lights that are coming out of the African continent in relation to women, their minds and their political process. One was many years ago when I was asked to recommend a person for giving the Rama Mehta Memorial Lecture at Harvard University. I've met many times in the African continent at the desk in UNIFEP. She struck me as brilliant, deeply engaged and political, and I thought maybe the constituents in Africa, in Harvard, should listen to her. But when she started to speak, the audience was bombed, shocked into an anxious silence. Professor John Kenneth Galbraith, about whom all of you must have heard, was one of the patrons of this lecture, sitting in the first row. I could feel his irritation and anxiety, because what Atula did was to just read out the names of women from the African continent who had achieved, who had led both intellectually and politically. It was like a poem, a roll call of honor, and I can still hear her saying, "Let me tell you about so and so and so." And then she'd give a name and all the things that person did. And then she would say so and so, like a roll call. So it got people really, you know, very tense. In a way, as I said earlier, there was astonishment and a sense of being bombed.
Madam, I'm so sorry, but your voice is very soft, so many participants can't hear. I'm so sorry to intervene. So if you can just come close to the desktop, because we have been, people are, participants are writing in the chat box that they can't hear you. You're very soft, madam. So if you can...
Speak slowly?
No, you can just speak loudly, ma'am. You're speaking very softly. Your voice is very soft. So the audio quality, so people are not able to hear. Participants are not able to hear. So ma'am, if you can just come a bit close. I'm so sorry to intervene. I'm extremely sorry to intervene.
My audio is all fine. I can see the microphone and the video, but I don't know.
They are saying they can hear, but with some strain, ma'am. Because in fact, I can hear you. In fact, I have no problem because maybe I'm using a earphone. So I'll request everyone to use a earphone, madam. I think I'll request everyone to please use a earphone.
And yeah, you will have to, Devkiji also, you'll have to come closer to the computer.
Yeah.
To the laptop, whatever, desktop.
So shall I continue then?
Yeah, yes. Continue.
Yeah. So later, Atula, why did she do that? She said to me, in all these northern countries, we the women and black people of Africa are seen as domestic workers or as slaves. And Africa is perceived as this dismal, dark continent where women and children are an underclass. They would have expected that I would hand out the beggar's bowl, which is what you see from Africa. More food, more this. I wanted to show that Africa had some stunning intellectual women in leadership. My lecture, in a sense, continues that conversation with Atula. It aims to show and share with you how this once dark continent was recognized by internal wars, intracontinental fighting on religious and tribal issues, and also the continent from where the slave trade flourished. Over the years, has transformed itself into a model of cooperative rebuilding of itself. The continent of Africa is also emerging as a new leader in feminist thought and continental feminist solidarity. The second pataka was a lecture by Grasa Machel, wife of the late Nelson Mandela. In 2015, I invited Gracha, wife of formerly of Samora Machel and later of course Nelson Mandela, to deliver a lecture in Oxford. My college in Oxford, St. Anne's, had honored me with a fellowship, which included a stay in the college for a term. The principal of the college, Tim Gordon, asked me to meet the feminist club in the college and speak to them on the Indian experience of feminist thought and action. As I spoke, it became clear the students did not have a clue on the way our countries, the non-Anglo-Saxon countries, had fired the engines of feminism. So I decided that as my contribution to the college, I would sponsor an annual lecture by a feminist from the South, not just originating from there, but living and engaging in the country. Hence, I invited Gracha, whom I had befriended earlier when my husband and I were in South Africa, to speak. Gracha called her lecture "Africa Through the Eyes of Its Women," and dramatized the ignorance of the other, that is us, people in other countries, in knowing Africa. Gracha started by saying, "To many of you, the image that is transmitted to you through the screens of your television and the media generally is that we, Africans, are dying of HIV/AIDS, poverty, and all those kinds of things. I want to tell you a different narrative of African women, who we are, how we see ourselves, our struggles, our fears, our successes, our doubts, how we are shaping our Africa for ourselves, for our children, for our grandchildren." She continued, "Women have been heads of many states," and she gave a whole lot of names, which of course I would love to recite, but it'll take time. Sylvia Kinigi, first female president of Burundi, Ellen Johnson, first president of Liberia, and there was so on and so on, 2001 Nobel Prize fellows. And then there was Catherine Samba, acting head of Central African Republic. So it was a kind of roll call of honor that she led out. And also a person called Osan Belepo, who was elected as president of Mauritius, and then Zewde, first elected president of Ethiopia. She then continued, and you have heard of women in politics, but she said you have not heard very little, you heard very little of women in business, women in science, women in media, women in culture, women in other sectors of life. You know very little, and it is our fault, she said. So then she gave a whole roll call. For example, a woman who negotiated a national debt of Nigeria, women who started an aviation company, women who started other businesses, to show that African women have come out and produced brilliant examples of successful stories in reshaping the continent. And she said then that she has now established a movement, new faces, new voices, to bring forward names of African women. In South Africa, Zenede Mbeki, a strong feminist activist, also wife of the former president of South Africa, Thabo Mbeki, supports new initiatives to bring racial harmony in a country which was driven and riven by race for conflict. She nurtures a society called SAWID, South African Women in Dialogue, and brings together in a camp in the University of Pretoria women from different races to live together for a couple of weeks and to try to get used to each other. They were inspired in turn by another peace and reconciliation dialogue which women in the Democratic Republic of Congo held. So through many three national conferences, South African women united in their diversity and came together to agree on a plan of action for development of their own communities. Zenede also initiated a charitable organization where she brings young women, PhDs and others, and carries them across to learn about feminists in all over the world. She also did something else which I wish I could talk to you about if you ask questions, and that is had a celebration by inviting African women from all the countries to celebrate Fatima Bernissi of Morocco. I was very fortunate to be invited to that, and it was one of the wonderful ways in which African women leaders come together when they have to celebrate another African. Now I come to the real point of this, that perhaps the most significant boom coming out from the continent is the theorizing and leading of feminist thought, claiming feminism as conceived by Africa and its heritage and ideas. Sylvia Tamale, a leading African feminist lawyer from Uganda, in her book, which actually is being released tomorrow on the web for those of you who want to open it, Sylvia Tamale dissects and demolishes what she calls the dangerous tropes of coloniality that destroyed our understanding of African societies, cultures, bodies, institutions, experiences, social relations and realities. Using the concept of intersectionality, she moves seamlessly and examines with a sense of fierce urgency the decolonial project over a wide range of spheres, from ecofeminism to sports, law, religion, human rights, Ubuntu, which is an African concept, which means I am there because you are, the academy, family relationships, pan-Africanism, big data. This whole range of subjects she tries to reclaim from African feminism. She argues that Afrofeminism works to reclaim the rich histories of Black women in challenging all forms of domination, and particularly as they relate to patriarchy, race, class, sexuality, and global imperialism. She writes, it is especially necessary to be alive and alert the histories of normative concepts that are presented as ahistorical, universal, and neutral, including human rights, race, gender, family, law. All these concepts which we have inherited also in India, she challenges and breaks them open. For example, she asks, how do we divert the paternalistic, fetishized, poisoned gaze of the Western reader from our beloved continent? How do we develop critical consciousness to counter racist, patriarchal, hegemonic power? Who will connect the ideological dots of racism, colonization, capitalism, sexism, heterosexism in ways that our children understand? Can we move beyond Eurocentric knowledge hegemonies? How do we navigate Eurocentric modernity without losing our Africanness? Africa is a vast continent, by the way, of 54 countries with diverse and rich cultures. It is thus impossible to generalize about Africa. And yet she argues that Africanness presents itself in the form of a lifelong conversation without an end, precisely because of ever-evolving, unfinished, unfolding multiplicities of conjectural African identifications at play in the grand drama of life. So then she continues to say that Africa should be treated as one historical unit, even though there are many, many African countries. And she says the common history of slavery, colonialism, and oppression should bind all these African 40 countries together. There is a concept which many of you who know Africa might have heard of, called Ubuntu. In a way, I think Gandhiji had that idea when she talked of I am because you are. And she therefore differentiates using Ubuntu from the Euro-American societies. And she says it's a significant idea. Well, traditionally it referred to Western Europe, North America, Australia, and China. Now she argues that there are a number of countries which are donating to build up Africa. And here she says, while Western Europe, North America, Australia, she adds China, Japan, South Korea, Russia, other, and I would like to include India, as I think that India also has become a donor. And she argues that this bringing in a financial capital has shown that our hegemony as Africa is losing. So she rejects that whole idea of what we call transfer of funds from these countries, because it says it also reduces that African solidarity. So she says then, this is a language which I know young feminists in India would like. It needs to be made clear from the outset that it is the neoliberal, white-centric, supremacist, binary, Cartesian, intellectually arrogant, depoliticizing kind of Western thought that we need to reject. And her book, which I just now told you about, called Decolonization and Afrofeminism, roundly rejects this inherited knowledge. Power and resistance are the themes that bind the chapters of this text together. The chapter also argues that the very concept of gender equality, which is roots located in the dynamic of a class structure inherent in a capitalist mode of production, rings hollow to the lived experiences of most African lords. And I may interject here what looks like claiming that at a conference called by Pranab Sen in Patna on gender, especially the theme was called gender budgeting and gender equality, I argued or put forward the proposal that gender equality should not be the aspiration of the feminist movement in India. We are not in a race with men. Our aspirations to be defined by us, strengthening our own ideas in building a just and peaceful society. This is what this young African feminist is also saying, that we do not want these concepts to be driving us. The African concept, again, of Ubuntu, I am because you are, she argues and flags that as an alternative for women's social justice. Until feminist analysis are mainstreamed into knowledge production and mainstream equality is dislodged, we will never get gender or strength as feminists. This, in my opinion, is what needs to be done here in India and South Asia. This was, in fact, IAWS founders' aim in developing gendered analysis of phenomena described or discussed in academia. I do not know, many of you have to tell me whether we have made that leap. When we founded this whole women's studies thing, and I was one of the founders, I hope that our analysis of what it happens when you do gendered analysis would then leap forward and transform theory in economics, philosophy, sociology, statistics, and only you can advise me whether this has been done. Transnational feminism. Some of the very first Africa-wide networks of women were academic ones. AWOD, African Association for Research and Development, was formed in 77, led by a Senegalese lawyer called Marie-Angelique Savani. It was the first continental network of women in the South. I met Marie at a very impressive other regional conference, also called Women in the Latin Labor Force, again in Latin America. It was AWOD, led by Marie-Angelique, that inspired me to build the intercontinental network called DAWN, which you must have heard of, in 83-84, to challenge the hegemony of the North in designing development in our countries. How important these continental and sub-regional interests are for our domestic policies, serving as a critical conduit for changing international norms. In this case, they are perhaps more important than global transnational interests as a vehicle for changing the status of women. Africa, for example, has emerged as a world leader in promoting women's leadership in politics. As a result of their pressures, they have managed to get regional organizations like SADC, ECOWAS, many of these whose I've spelled out in my lecture, to include women. At one time, we too in South Asia had developed many regional networks, some of which had in fact penetrated into officials, but not as much as they have. And you may see, we have got so many South Asian networks. Why are you emphasizing Africa? The difference is that in Africa, women are political leaders, heads of state, heads of regional economic structures, very visible as continental figures. In South Asia, even though we have one woman in Bangladesh, there's no political feminist backup to her, nor are the other women leaders in the region. This is something that we are denied and we do not know how to do it, but I think we have lots to learn. So I do not think the few women that we had in North, like Mary Robinson and others, didn't generate a flavor of all feminism. But I think in Africa, they managed to bring the flavor called feminism as a politics. And I suggest that we work well for us, whether in gender studies or otherwise, to be engaged with the waves that are taking place in the African continent, especially their intellectual discourse. I really think there's much to learn from there, and I hope many of you students and scholars of women's studies in India would like to take some interest in what's happening there and see if we could bring some of that pugnacity into our women's studies and make it into a political movement, whereas now it is marginalized as an academic movement. I thank SNDT, and particularly Putul, for thinking of me and inviting me to be with all of you at SNDT. A dream has come true. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, madam. That was a very thought-provoking lecture. And I'm glad that you also introduced us to a new voice. I think we should be at the center. We'll definitely have a look at the book, and of course, we'll try to engage with the scholar. May I now request Sangeeta Desai to introduce Dr. Veena Punacha as the guest of honor. Sangeeta?
Yes, I'm there.
Yeah.
Good evening. It's a privilege and honor to introduce the eminent academician, Professor Veena Punnacha. She was a former director of the Research Center for Women's Studies, RCWS, at SNDT Women's University. She was also the honorary director of the Center for Rural Development. Professor Punnacha has many accolades to her credit. A teacher and a mentor par excellence, she is the recipient of the Best Teacher Award from SNDT Women's University during its centennial celebrations in 2015. She has received the Pride of India Maharashtra Award from WCRC Leaders Asia for her special contribution to education. During her long academic career, she has contributed significantly to the growth of women's studies scholarship through her research, publication, and teaching. It was due to her tireless efforts and under her stellar leadership that the Dr. Avabai Wadia and Dr. Bomanji Khurshedji Wadia Archives for Women was set up at the university. She was also instrumental in starting the RCWS teaching program through the introduction of MA and PhD program in Women's Studies. It is during her tenure as the Director of Women's Studies that various research programs and research initiatives and publications were brought out at the center. Professor Punnacha was herself mentored by none other than Professor Neera Desai, the pioneer of women's studies in India. It was the initiative and efforts of Professor Punnacha that the Neera Desai Memorial Lecture Series commenced at RCWS from the year 2009. Professor Punnacha's expertise was sought both at the state and the national level. She was the consultant to the Prime Minister High Level Committee, Government of India. She was also on the task force on microfinance constituted by the Chief Minister of Maharashtra. She also spearheaded the minority report, which was initiated by the Maharashtra State Minority Commission. She was on the advisory board of various state committees for women, including MAVIM, Mahila Arthik Vikas Mahamandal. A great scholar, a great teacher, and a mentor, and more importantly, a genuinely wonderful person. Let us welcome Professor Veena Punnacha.
Thank you, Sangeeta. You make me blush. Thank you. It is indeed an honor for me to be on the same platform as Professor Devaki Jain, as one of the guiding lights of the women's movement. Your work in Dawn documents, for instance, has shaped my own work on development, sustainable development, and the human face of providing a sustainable development. And I'm indeed honored to be present here in this Neera Desai Memorial Lecture, as Neera Ben was my guide. It is from her I learned about the need for scholarship and activism. Scholarship is meaningless if it is not linked to action. And that is why I had to take up the Center for Rural Development program as my voluntary honorary contribution to the research to the SNDT University. As I begin now, I'd like to thank Professor Devaki Jain for her extremely powerful lecture on African feminisms. I use the term feminisms in the plural because of the rich cultural diversity of Africa and its many struggles against colonial and neo-colonial domination. These forms of domination have resulted in the erosion of an ancient culture and egalitarian communities built on the principle of separate but equal. Here I go back to Esther Bostrup's early writings in the 1970s when she describes the kind of African communities that existed. As well as in the Dawn document, we get the feel of the multiplicities of cultural communities in Africa and the kind of gender relationships that existed in indigenous African communities. I'm sure that all those who are listening to this lecture will agree that Professor Jain's lecture is an eye-opener and a necessary part of decolonizing our intellectual frames of reference. by and large, perhaps because, as Professor Jain has also indicated, that we have treated the West as our reference point, Africa has never been a site of knowledge or inspiration. We have not engaged with African writers, thinkers, or empathized with their aspirations. Our knowledge of Africa has been shaped by Western writers like Rider Haggard and John and Joseph Conard as the dark, mysterious continent, a point which Professor Jain has also highlighted, a continent inhabited by warlike and man-eating tribes, a site of danger and adventure from young men from Europe and England, of course. I mean, this is something which comes out from Joseph Conard's and Rider Haggard's writings. It is within this literary genre that African exploration and conquest was highlighted. Women in their narratives were seen as dark and dangerous and mysterious women, mysterious as the continent itself, and objects of male fascination and voyeurism. The African woman's body was a site of exploitation and satiation, just as the rich natural resources of Africa was there for European consumption. Our own contemporary knowledge of African continues to be shaped by the Western media reports of humanitarian crisis, famines, HIV/AIDS, and civil unrest. The images that dominate our minds is that of starving children of Africa in need of UN aid. What is not highlighted is the continued colonial domination and the exploitative global economics that requires the resources from Africa to satisfy global European market in particular. What is returned to them in the form of UN aid, as Professor Devaki Jain has also pointed out, and also other countries offering financial security to African countries, is but a pittance of what is taken out of that continent. My own takeaway from Professor Jain's lecture is a need to engage more thoroughly with African thinkers and writers. As Professor Jain has pointed out, we cannot forget our shared history of colonialism and the close trade relations that we have had with Africa since ancient times. The history of the Siddhi communities in Gujarat is an indication of this connection. And yet, it's a shameful history because of India's participation in slave trade. Perhaps the difference between the Indian and African slave trade is that many of the Siddhis rose to high ranks in the courts of Indian kings. Here, I'm particularly referring to the Bahamani kings of the Deccan. And were remarkable for their courage, sagacity, and wisdom. Similarly, the roots of a nationalist movement since the advent of Mahatma Gandhi has a strong South African base. As is well known, Mahatma Gandhi's experiment with Satyagraha began in South Africa, and it was against racial segregation. What is perhaps not so well known is the influence that Sarojini Naidu had on mentoring African women's political aspirations for equality. Sent by Mahatma Gandhi to South Africa between 1920s and 1930s, Sarojini Naidu was unanimously elected as the president of the South African Indian Congress and was deeply entwined in their political histories during this period. He encouraged African women to engage in political struggles, and in her many public speeches spoke of racial equality. The importance of Professor Jane's lecture is that she has drawn our attention to this ruptured history of India and Africa and indicated that African feminisms have different identities based on their historical experiences of colonization and engagement with indigenous issues. They cannot even be subsumed under transnational feminisms of women of color. They are distinctly African and rooted in their own experience. Growing out of the specificities of these histories in different countries of Africa, these feminisms have breed new life into transnational feminisms. They have experimented in new forms of identities from mothering to Negro identities, etc. India, it is as diverse perhaps as Indian feminisms. And therefore, I would like to conclude my brief remark with the agreement that we need to engage, and I'm sure many of the participants here are already doing it, with African literature, and not necessarily with Afro-American literature. In fact, I think the African feminists have a critique of the Afro-American writings as well. Thank you.
May I just say a few words? I want to hold this because a lot of people are asking for Tamale's book title. So yeah. Those of you who are here still.
Yeah, I think we would love to.
Tamale's book title. Yes. And the other is the book that I have just completed, my memoirs, is now available everywhere. It's produced by speaking title.
Thank you very much. Thank you. We will definitely look at it.
Yeah, so Professor Devki Jain, can we, would you like to answer the questions? There are plenty of questions in the chat box, so I can just read out the questions one by one and you could answer the questions.
Could you ask that question again, please?
I said there are many questions which are there in the chat box. So may I read them out to you and you would like to answer them?
Okay. Maybe you should just send me a mail and I'll send you a mail with that. Maybe
okay. So I'll just...
Simple, it's devikijain@gmail.com.
I'll just do that. Definitely I'll do that. Okay. So I'll just tell you,
Sylvia Tamale, the author of this book from whom I learned a great deal about...
Africa.
Is right here, part of this... I wrote to her about it, so she joined.
She's here. She has joined, and she has mentioned the title of her book in the chat.
That is when I'm here, she says, Sylvia Tamale.
Yeah. Okay, so now I request. There are so many questions coming. Vatsala, can you please see the questions?
I have taken note of all these questions. I have made a word file. And which Devki madam is saying that we will be sending it through her through email. I have taken note of everything. I have made a word file.
So now I request Dr. Vatsala Shukla to propose the vote of thanks.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Kupul Sathe. On behalf of the Research Center for Women's Studies, SNDT Women's University, Mumbai, I express my heartfelt gratitude to all dignitaries and senior scholars, friends of Neera Bain, who present here today with us to commemorate 95th birth anniversary of Neera Bain. I would like to take this opportunity to record my deep regard and sincere thanks to Madam Vice Chancellor for her gracious presence and encouraging words on this very special day. I express my profound respect and sincere appreciation to the eminent feminist scholar, Dr. Dev Chang for accepting our invite and gracing the occasion with her esteemed presence as a special speaker for 11th Dr. Neera Desai Memorial Lecture and sharing her invaluable insights on the emergence of feminist leadership from Africa. Indeed, her feminist scholarship and contribution have influenced and shaped the ideas of countless women like me, particularly her seminal contribution on women's work, the tyranny of the household, women in development debates, women's politics, and others. Madam, we feel truly honored to have you on the occasion and get the chance to listen to you. Thank you, ma'am. I would like to record my deep regard and admiration to Professor Vardhuti Patel for sharing her memories and emotional connect with Neera Bain with us. Thank you, Vibhuti Bain, for being with us today. I would also like to take this opportunity to express my heartfelt thanks to former Arts Director, Professor Veena Punacha, for being with us as the guest of honor and sharing insights and concluding remarks. With 11th Dr. Neera Desai Memorial Lecture, we have also come to conclude the 1 month online gender sensitization and capacity development program on humanitarian crisis during COVID-19, which was organized by the Research Center for Women's Studies, SNDT Women's University, Mumbai, in collaboration with University Grants Commission, New Delhi, from 24th August to 23rd September, 2020. May I also take the opportunity to express my sincere gratitude and deep appreciation towards all special speakers of 1 month online lecture series. We had speakers from across disciplinary boundaries, including women's studies scholars, sociologists, gender historians, gender economists, disability studies experts, transgender activists, and from across territorial locations, including academic scholars from City University of New York, University of Quebec, University of Dhaka, and from different universities and institutions in India. We feel truly honored to host these senior scholars who have brought in multitude of ideas and perspectives from their intersectional, interdisciplinary, and gender location. Indeed, we are very privileged to get this opportunity to connect and listen to them virtually. These lectures were recorded and soon will be available on our RCWS YouTube channel. I would request all participants to subscribe to our channel to get access to the recordings of the previous as well as future sessions organized by the RCWS. You can also visit RCWS Facebook page for updates on the upcoming events. Finally, a big thanks to our participants who come from different fields as faculties, research scholars, activists, and students, and who have joined from different geographical locations from India and abroad. I deeply acknowledge each participant's contribution, enthusiasm, and support towards the success of the 1 month lecture series. I truly believe that it is you who made it happen. All participants are requested to fill up the feedback form, which we will be sending to all registered participants through email. You will be receiving e-certificate through your registered email. Last but not the least, I appreciate and thank Dr. Sangeeta Desai, Mr. Milind Prabhulkar, and the entire RCWS staff under an able headship of Dr. Putul Sathe for working tirelessly and providing strength throughout the month-long event. Without this collective spirit, efforts, technical support, on-screen and off-screen management and coordination, the program would not have taken the shape it did. Thank you so much.
Vatsala, about Mihir.
Mihir.
Would you like to say?
Yeah, I would also like to take this opportunity to record my deep appreciation to all eminent scholars, especially the activist and also advocate Mihir Desai for being with us on the occasion. It's really a very, it's an honorable honor. We feel very honor to have you here. Thank you, Advocate Mihir Desai, for being with
us. My privilege.
Would you like to speak, Mihir? Would you like to say something?
I just say that, thank you very much for organizing this year after year. Thank you, Professor Jain, and thank you, Veena, for being there and remembering my mother. It was an excellent program, that's all. I wish we were together in one physical space, but that's not possible. So this is the best we could have done. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mihir. Thank you, Mihir. It's so nice to see you. Yes.
Yeah.
I had a meeting together to celebrate Neera Ben's life and achievements.
So thank you, Professor Devki Jain. Thank you, Professor Devki Jain. I thank you once again for having accepted the invitation and for having delivered the 11th Dr. Neera Desai Memorial Lecture. I wish we meet actually, and we can, and I look forward to meeting you soon. Yeah. Vibhuti?
Thank you very much, all
of you. Yes, ma'am. Yeah. I really hope that we meet soon. In fact, I am looking forward to the release of your book event. Please do send me the link, because you said it's on 30th of October at India International Center. I have already ordered the book from Amazon, so it should be arriving soon. So I really look forward to your book release event, ma'am. And thank you, madam. Thank you.
If this is an online event, we would all like to be at least joining the event of book release or the recording of that.
We certainly will buy Dr. Jain's book. It must be a fascinating book. And of course,
I'm so glad you said that. I promoted it like crazy.
yeah, we are definitely going to buy that book. It's so fascinating to think of it.
No, it doesn't have any much about feminism. It's really much more about politics.
Yeah. No, but that's fascinating. The personal is political, right?
Yeah, very important.
Any person, maybe you'll agree with me. We don't walk only the feminist journey. We keep our
Yes. Thank you, Professor Jain. Thank you. And I hope we do get an opportunity to meet soon. I keep on repeating, but I really look forward to meeting you. Since I've read your essays, I've also purchased your...
And bear this business of not shaming
me. Yes.
I don't like web conversations at all. It feels crazy.
True.
We do it to please other people. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam. Thank you,
Veena ma'am. Thank you, Vibhuti ma'am.
Yeah, thank you, Veena.
Thank you, Pundu.
Thank you so much. It's always a pleasure for me to be with the RCWS team. Thank you very much.
And thank you, Veena. Yes.
Thank you. Yeah. It's just all my feelings coming out. Yes. I do care about all of you. Thank you.
And thank you, Vibhuti. Vibhuti is also.